here tonight. Thank you, Lord, for all you want to do in us and through us. We just open our hearts completely to you. Have your way. We just thank you, God, for expanding our way of thinking, our way of seeing things, and just preparing us for the greater glory that you've called us into. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, the forms you picked up at the table, if you did, number one, weekly, I'm going to be giving you a packet of the two lessons that we're going to go over. So you got that. I have it in this small little book form. You guys got it. Didn't give it to you all at once because I don't want you to go ahead of yourself.
So rest
2 weeks at a time. You also got a completed assignment. This is what, if you are a Wagner student and you are not auditing, but you have had your assessment with Dr. Ralph, or you're going to, then you need to fill this out. This is what you need to fill in and turn in to me. Okay, that just... So make sure you get that form and fill it in and turn it in to me. Don't worry about the books read, that's for other type of things you can do, and I'll talk more about that. Besides taking these courses, if you are a student with Wagner, you can get credit for many different things. Half your degree can come from life experience, your own book reading. Mm-hmm. You can do book reading, and if it's approved, it has to be a book that, you know, would be beneficial to ministry. You can get credit for that. So if you ever want to do that, I have forms just for WLI Global Reading Approval Form, and you can get up to one training unit, which is the same as credit, for every 250 pages read. And then there's an evaluation form that you have to do to go along with it. Okay, that's that. There is a few other forms. I printed them and I don't see them. But you can get, you can even do your own field assignment. Let's say you, like Brother Wolf is stepping out in ministry with working with people with addictions and mm-hmm. all kinds of stuff. You can do a whole field assignment on that type of activity and get credit for it. So half your degree can be that type of stuff. Missions, trips, and all that kind of stuff. So I have forms for all that if you ever have to pay for the training units for it. Mm-hmm. So just wanted to let you know about that. So what you should have in your hands there that's on the table is form you filled out, two chapters that we're going to go over tonight, and is that it? I thought there was one other form. Oh, yeah, that's it right here. The self-evaluation. Mm-hmm. Okay, at the end of this course, which is in 6 weeks, to get credit for the course, even if you're just doing it as an audit, mm-hmm. and you can still get a certificate from PB, from Praise Bible Institute, you'd still need to have this form. And it tells you exactly what you need to do to get credit for the course. It's basically an essay. So that's it. So the only work you really got to do besides coming to class is the essay at the end, which is 3 to 5 pages. Typical college type essay. It used to just be 3 questions, it's like 2 pages. But I found out today, it's a little bit more work. Mm-hmm. Which is good, do a little bit more work. So it was easier, now it's harder. Not too hard. All right, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Wagner Leadership Institute. Just at a glance, if you want to find out more, just go onto the website. Just Google Wagner Leadership Institute and you'll find out more. But just a little bit about Wagner Leadership Institute. I have my degree from WLI, my ministry degree. Wagner Leadership Institute is a network of international apostolic training centers established to equip the saints for kingdom ministry. That's the vision of WLI. The mission, it was founded in 1998. WLI reflects a new paradigm for unique training and practical ministry. Students learn a creative, revelatory atmosphere of teaching, impartation, and activation with opportunity for hands-on. That's what we're going to do a lot of. Every session, which we'll do 2 sessions every Monday, they'll be hands-on. So we're going to do some hands-on tonight. that's really the heart of WLI. A lot of classrooms are just sit and listen, do work, and you don't really have applicable opportunities. So the course, different than the foundational, will be much more applicable. We're going to do hands-on stuff, which I'm going to encourage all the teachers to do the same. We provide the highest level of training and spiritual impartation through a successful faculty of internationally known leaders. So besides our classes here present, you can take online courses. Actually, to get a degree, you are required to do 6 online courses. Some of the best teachers, many of them, if you are aware of well-known teachers in the body of Christ, you will know many of the people that are in WLI as professors. The students obtain a living, functioning impartation and activation from the Holy Spirit to walk in the divine destiny. So again, it's a lot more impartational than it is informational. You can take notes, but it might not be as many notes as a typical class where it's information-based, because we're all going to be about impartation. The main campus is in Pasadena, California. Peter Wagner, who is the founder of Wagner Leadership Institute, just passed away a couple months ago. He's one of the founders of the current apostolic move. And now Cheyenne has replaced Peter Wagner. Actually, that took place a couple years ago as the president of WLI. Basically, everything else you don't need to know.
Okay.
If you need to know, go to WLI.org and you'll find out more information. So let's get to class. Amen?
Amen.
That stuff's out of the way. I like just teaching. All right, so we're going into implementing apostolic ministry. Implementing apostolic ministry. I took this course, and the author of this course, I'm going to add my own little twist here and there, but it's Apostle John Kelly. Apostle John Kelly is the overseer of International Apostolic, the Coalition of International Apostolic Leaders, something like that. I was a member of it, but I just stopped being a member. It costs a lot of money, bottom line.
Right.
And I was tired of traveling all the time. But John Kelly, I've met him, he's from Jersey, wonderful man. Big dude, football player, former steel worker. Just great guy with really, he's hardcore. Kind of mean. But funny. The funny kind of mean, I like it. Jersey, New York style. Good guy. So he's the one that wrote this course. And so I'm just going to kind of go over what he wrote and then add whatever God gives me. Let's go right into it. Session 1, implementing a prophetic mandate. What does the word implement mean to you?
Put into action.
Yeah, exactly it. Put a decision plan into effect. Put a decision plan into effect. An apostle. Anybody know what an apostle is?
Apostle is, one definition is an apostle who's someone who walked with Christ, and another is someone who is seen Christ or starts churches.
Yes, that's yep.
It's teaching you're in.
Hopefully we're all walking in Christ and we're all called to be apostolic, prophetic, pastoral, evangelistic, you know, we're all called to teach.
Yeah.
So we're all called to have the fivefold ministry implemented in us. So the apostle though is an ambassador of the one who sent him. So Jesus Christ, of course, has sent us all. And we're all, the Bible says, we're all ambassadors. So we're all called to be apostolic. You know, apostles, a general in the body of Christ with a specific assignment. You know, 12 years ago, when I felt called here to Praise Tabernacle, I felt God commissioned me here. I didn't feel like I was just getting a job. I felt like I had an assignment. And so apostles feel like they have an assignment and they have to complete the assignment before they can move on. And my assignment was to help transition this church and see this region an apostolic base arise. For our church, I've said this many times, not just to be a hospital where the wounded come, but where the wounded get healed and then become soldiers and then be sent out.
Amen.
So we're beyond just getting help, where we're now making a difference in the world around us, changing the world. Come on in.
John.
So we're, that is my heart, that was my mission, that was my, you know, so apostolic people usually feel like that. They feel like God has given them a direct mission. Okay, apostolic ministry is to implement the prophetic mandate that God has given to the church. I really felt like even in this year, 2017, that part of the words I gave, it was completion, perfection, and fulfillment. That the fulfillment part is we need an apostolic initiative to fulfill the prophetic. That's the key. Often in prophetic circles, there's a lot of prophesying and a lot of hope and a lot of running after things, but not a lot of those things actually taking place, going through. The heart of the apostle and apostolic people is not just to hear a prophetic word and get excited about it, because I'm not really excited about it until I see it happen. It's great, the possibility of what could happen, but I want to see it happen, so I want to, I'm like, God, what do I got to do to see this actually take place? I don't want my heart to get sick, my hope, you know, hope deferred, the heart gets sick, so I don't want that to happen. I want to see action, I want to see movement. I love to see God's people moving. So the other day, the best thing for me is when people get up and start testifying of what God's doing through them. I'm like, oh, really? Okay. Things are happening. Things are moving.
Amen.
I love it. Apostolic ministry moves from proclamation and impartation to implementation. And that's why we have the monthly prophetic service. Why I combined it and made it a prophetic apostolic service is so what I do is I take what the prophetic team is hearing and I seek God for God now with what they're hearing, what are some action points? How can we make this become reality? What are some practical instructions that I can give God's people so they can begin walking it out? In the book of Acts, the Apostle Peter spoke of the fulfillment of prophecy and the restoration of all things. If you ever hear apostolic people teach, they'll teach from these four scriptures often, like all the time. Like this is like the apostolic teaching of teachings.
Handbook.
All the time. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of all his prophets that the Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things. Right there, that's the underlined part of the apostolic message. So restoration of all things. That's the heart of the apostolic. To see people restored, but not just people. To see culture, to see communities, to see nations restored, to see every area of society restored.
Unity,
everybody together, working together and seeing God's kingdom come in every area. Like I was teaching on Sunday regarding conduct, you know, reading from Leviticus 19, it dealt with the specifics. God is very specific. We often get caught up in the deep spiritual stuff, even the fruit of the Spirit, you know, the characteristics of Christ, but the conduct of what it looks like, holiness in every aspect of our life every day, sometimes doesn't get taught that often. But this is what God's desire is, to restore all things in every area of life and everything his way, God's way. The apostolic is about the return of Christ and those things which must occur before he comes. So we, apostolic people usually love the prophetic. This time of year, 2017, what is God saying to the church? You know, and then saying, now, okay, what now do I do with that? So I often guide my year, and even what we're teaching on Sunday mornings, I kind of encourage Pastor Steve in what way we should go considering what God is saying prophetically so that our messages are moving us somewhere. We're not just teaching whatever, but it has an apostolic purpose. It's moving God's people somewhere. So this year, since I feel like the word is completion and perfection, we're going to teach, after we're done with this, with Leviticus, we're going to teach in the book of James. And James deals with overcoming, why you go through tests and trials. So we're going to complete this process. Said a lot of us have been going through this continual test over and over, and many people have failed the test. And the cool thing with God is He allows us to repeat it until we get it. But let this be the year we pass the test and move on to the next test. So in that, we need to understand overcoming. So we're going to do a series on James called Overcome. And then we're going to go back to the Old Testament. We're going to teach from Exodus, the journey, understanding how to get from Egypt to the Promised Land, which that's like my heartbeat, because I'm being Joshua.
Yeah.
I'm going to enjoy Exodus. It's going to be fun. It's all about, and in it all, it's all preparing the church for Christ's return, preparing the way, restoring all things. All things that the prophets have spoken must occur. That which the prophets saw and heard, we will see and hear in the end time church. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets. You see, Jesus, and throughout his life, what did it always say? It says, as it was written, as it was written, so he did. You know, that was apostolic. He was just fulfilling prophecy. Jesus' whole life was an apostolic life. Mm-hmm. He fulfilled the prophecy of the Old Covenant. Everything that was prophesied in the Old, he was fulfilling in the New. And then as we moved into the book of Acts, what happened? Jesus prophesied, go into Jerusalem and wait. And when you pray and wait, tarry, and the Holy Spirit will come. And then action. Book of Acts was all action. Apostles, apostolic people are all about action. They can't just sit idle and watch the world go to hell in a handbasket. He can say, we got to make a difference. God has given me power and authority. I can't just play church and wait to go to glory. No way. Not satisfied with that. So God spoke to the prophets in various ways, and the prophets did not always understand what it was they were hearing. The prophet is to speak the word, often without understanding its interpretation. Prophets often, who are young and immature, try to overstep their bounds, meaning they try to interpret what God never told them to interpret.
Just say it.
That's it. Leave it. So maturity, you learn that, but often it's not the prophet's role to really always have the understanding. It's more of the apostle's role. Apostolic role is to get the interpretation, understanding what to really do with that prophetic word. That's why God loves the fivefold to work together. I will tell you that now. The fivefold is represented by the hand. Fivefold ministry, you got all five together, you got a fivefold punch.
Right.
That's what's necessary to take out the devil. So here we have, what do you think that is?
The prophetic.
That represents the teacher. The teacher on the finger, the pinky, is what balances the hand. The teacher keeps balance, because all the others can go extreme without the balance of teachers. Next we have the wedding ring, married to the church. That's that finger, the marriage finger, and they're intimately connected to the people of the church. They're shepherding, caring, compassionate, looking out over them. And you got the middle finger, which extends. It's the farthest finger extending out.
Mm-hmm.
So their heart, passion, all they think about is souls.
That would be evangelism or?
Evangelist, yeah. The middle finger. Then you have the pointing finger. Can you think?
Teacher.
Think of Joel.
Teacher.
Prophet.
Yeah.
Think of Joel.
Thus saith the Lord. But it's more individual, prophetic for that individual, helping that person find their identity. That's there. And then you got the thumb. which represents strength. Apostolic people are very strong in the Lord. That's what they're supposed to be about. We're all to be strong in the Lord, but they have an extra strength. And the thumb is the only one that can reach all the fingers. So the apostle is gifted with the ability to unite the other parts together. So you have a team. They're all about team ministry. And they're all about supporting the others, mm-hmm. so the others can be elevated.
So the thumb is strength, which is the apostle. Mm-hmm.
That's the fivefold punch. Once to the message, call that fivefold punch.
Mm-hmm. Can you have all five?
As believers, we should all have the grace of all. That's how we mm-hmm. grow, as it says, and yeah. as we're going to go to that scripture soon. You need all four. It's the five nutrients for spiritual growth. Mm-hmm. Really need all five to really grow healthy
right.
and strong mm-hmm. and become all you call to be.
Yeah.
Different ones can lean in many of the giftings. Prophet Dan, what was his name that was here a few years ago now, from South Africa?
Dave McDonald.
Dave, yeah, he crossed it over to me that I lean in four of the five. You know, some stronger than the others, but you know, you can step into different ones at different times, depending on
what your call is.
Cool.
An apostle is often connected to the others, so that's probably why they have that grace. You know. And apostolics, what I've been studying since probably 1999. I've spent countless hours studying the apostolic. Read book after book after book after book. I emphasized through Wagner the apostolic in my degree. In 2000, and I think it was two or so, I got a hold of a book that was 750 pages called, what was it called? Habits. My Next to the Bible is the most important book I've ever read. And it just blew me away. Everything that was inside of me, I was reading it on the paper, and it was like, it's feeling like the book was. We're having a connection.
Mm-hmm.
Just getting intimate with the book. It was like alive. Just like the Bible.
Do with apostolic?
Yeah, it was Apostle Jonathan David? I think so. I'll show you guys the book sometime. It's a very good book. I'll remember.
Jonathan
Next time
David.
I'll tell you, remind me. I probably have it in my I usually give it out a lot though, but it's such a powerful book. So I read it in 1 week. It just
wow.
set me on fire. It just tells you all about how the church should look like when it's apostolically, you know, connected. So it was really cool. All right. God spoke to the prophets in various ways, and the prophets did not always understand what they were. I said that. Oh, this must have said that. Okay. Why do we need apostles? Well, the church is out of order. Church boards, voting constitution, and bylaws have been the norm. While biblical church government built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, we know that in the word, right? So that the church is built on the foundation of what? The apostles and the prophets.
Hmm.
Of course, that can mean the prophets of the old covenant were the big part of the, and the apostles really brought forward the church in the new covenant. But apostles and prophets are still to have a key role in the government of the church. The apostle's role is more like a governor. That's the grace on them. And again, Jesus is apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. We're not. I'm not. You're not.
Mm-hmm.
None of us are those things. Jesus just flows through us all in different ways.
Amen.
So we can never take credit
mm-hmm.
to who it is, because it's the apostle is a man, and it's Jesus. The prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. It's one man, like the song Stephen sang yesterday. Who is this man? That's the man. He's all five in one. He is all, but he's distributed gifts through his spirit in us so that now he is alive in many people through these different giftings. So why do we need apostles? The church, okay, is out of order, blah, blah, blah. The church cannot expect to fulfill the mandate of God without following his formula. Prophets don't always know what they're talking about. We said that apostles are gifted to interpret and implement the response, especially words over cities, nations, and individual churches. Apostles bring order to the church. That's their desire, to see order. They don't like chaos, and they hate the flesh.
Yeah.
when churches run fleshy, which it can be. I mean, the crazy stuff you hear when you've been around the church. How many of us have been around the church for a long time? Mm-hmm. Crazy stuff that goes on. Competition, you know, power trips, people trying to take over, trying to be in charge. You know, I get it all the time. Crazy people say, so when are you going to be in charge? You know, it's just like, that's what this is all about. What kingdom are we really part of?
Amen.
That's like the world, you know? Kingdom of God is not that way. We're supposed to be humble, broken vessels. And everything's to be done in the Spirit. You know, so who are we to be caught up in all that stuff? You know, we've got praise and worship team, one person going out to the other, I want to be the one mainly singing and all that, you know. You'll have somebody trying to sound louder than everybody else, so they're the ones that people hear. Yeah. I mean, nonsense that goes on, it's all flesh, and that stuff grieves, should grieve all of us, but apostles are extremely grieved by flesh stuff. Yeah. Just don't get it. Why didn't we get saved from all that? So, let's just get in the Spirit. Church is like a lighthouse on a hill, but it has been captured by the system of the world. We're supposed to be not like the world, but being transformed out of the world, no longer being conformed to the world. 2 Corinthians 10:3-4 says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. We still have flesh. We're still in it. But we're not supposed to walk and war according to it. We don't do things like we used to. In the world, how did we get, if to say in the world, if you wanted to be on top, what did you do? It's a dog-eat-dog world. So you do whatever it takes to get on top. But we don't fight the way we did in the flesh. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. Our weapons come only through the Spirit. We have spiritual weapons for the pulling down of strongholds. So the church is entering into a new realm. We are entering a war. You cannot make peace with the enemy without taking a loss. The first apostles were affected because they understood the purpose of God. They understood that they were engaged in warfare for souls. So apostolic people are all about war. Soldiers, militant, that kind of terminology will constantly come out of the mouth. They make sure the church is operating by the principles of faith. Apostles. Ephesians 1, 9-12 says, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will.
It's so awesome.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's what we desire, just to see his will come forth through it all. The purpose in everything. God works out all things for good. You know, there's people will see things like, if you watch the Golden, what was on last night?
Golden Globes. I did like TV.
Hollywood is so freaked out by Donald Trump being president. They're just losing their minds.
I did like 2 minutes of it. I was like, okay.
And the way he speaks on Twitter and everything else and the crazy comments that he makes, he's so unpresidential. Mm. But God works all things for good.
Yes.
And through it all, it's all going to work for good for God's people.
Amen.
Might not make sense for people in the world, but when you know God, he turns the foolish things.
Right. That's what he did in the Bible. Every person he ever used was a person that was like a Donald Trump.
Hothead.
That's his all.
No control of the tongue.
He saw the potential in the person.
Somehow, you can turn around, but that just...
Now, if he could use a donkey, he can use Donald.
Yep. So all we got to see in everything, no matter who, what, God, how are you going to turn this for good? How can I see this? Let me see it through my eyes. Let me not be a political person. Let me be a spiritual person. Let me be a person that moves by revelation, you know, not information from news and from other sources. I need revelation from God to understand everything that's going on around me.
I feel like it's... that green is like, it's, for me anyway, daily, it's like a adventure puzzle type of thing. Like, you can see the box, like, you know it's going to be really cool, but you're waiting for them to put all the pieces together.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So you like, you see a piece over here, like, oh, that's going to be, oh, even though that's not it, and then he keeps adding it. So it kind of makes things exciting because it doesn't throw me. Like, I don't worry about the economy and this, that, and the other, and so on and so forth, because it's kind of really has nothing to do with me.
Seems like more exciting than ever.
It's
been the oddest way things turn out, but it's kind of exciting. Like, what's going to happen?
What's going to be next? Yeah, this would be good. Who needs TV? Anyway.
It's a mystery. I love a mystery. Anybody love watching mystery movies?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, you don't. Those ones that you can't figure out to the end, I usually get it, but you know, that's okay. So I love God's mysteries. And the coolest thing with being God's sons and daughters is that He reveals the hidden mysteries to us.
Yeah.
We just spend some time with Him.
Amen.
Donna, while she's running, receiving mysteries. It's just in those times where we can just get away and hear from God and free from distractions. Often those are the times when mysteries get revealed.
The downloads, as Donna calls them. Mm-hmm.
And that's really the heart of apostles as well, or apostolic people, is to get along with God, to get away. When I was ordained apostolically, there was one word that Walt Healy preached: my responsibility is just to get up on the mountain and stay there. You know, don't come down much. You gotta come up. But apostles need to spend a lot of time in prayer and the Word. They can't be involved in too many activities, too much work. They're called to release the mysteries of God to His people.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I've been cutting off one thing after another so I can get back to where I'm supposed to be. You know, I don't even like spending a lot of time counseling and meeting people, doing weddings and funerals and all that pastoral stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Though I'll do it here and there. I just got called today from one of our old youth from way back when. Wants me to do his wedding. I was like, okay. It's not exciting to me at all, really. But I'll do it because I want to honor the person. And then my best friend growing up, not really best friend anymore, he wants me to do his wedding. And I got to do some weddings this year. But at least the second wedding is in Washington State in a lodge with a waterfall.
There you go.
The lodge is right there. The waterfall comes right down.
Wow.
It's like the top one of the top lodges in the world. So that one will be worth it.
That's a plus.
Just for the view. Some of my family, but that's our heart. That's why we see in the book of Acts when the apostles start doing all this work because of the needs around them. All these people are getting saved. And that's an awesome problem. They had so many people saved and so many people in need because the heart of the Father is to take care of the orphans and the widows.
Uh-huh.
And so they were doing because they have the heart of the Father. But thank God He said, okay, get back to what you're supposed to do. That's an important thing, but I'm going to put somebody else responsible for that. Stephen and the deacon ministry started and all that. Yeah. Thank God for deacons, right?
Yeah.
So I putting paperwork together, anything, is just a burden to me. I like just to show up and preach. Even a Sunday doing announcements, that's almost a burden. Just having to think of anything besides the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to just preach the Word and let God move through me, and that's it. Anyway, hallelujah. Here we go. The mandate of the ecclesia, which is the church, is to fulfill a specific purpose. But it's the restoration of all things. The restoration of all things. The apostles are called to reconnect the head to the body. So often they can get disconnected. Say the headless horseman is the church. The body trying to do all this work, and they're not connected to the head. Can't do too much without a head. And Jesus is our head. So the goal of the apostle is to always make sure the body and the head are one. Whatever we're doing, it's coming from the head. We're not just doing it from the body, from what we think of. Because what we think of, we're not the head. We don't have much of a brain without the head. So what we think is such a great idea, such an awesome ministry, might just be a total waste of time and fruitless activity. So we need to get everything we're supposed to do from the head, Jesus Christ. That's it. why it says in John 15, every fruit, every branch that doesn't bear fruit, what does God do? Cut it off. Pruner, cut it off. So we have to examine everything in the church. What isn't bearing fruit? Cut it off. Eliminate it. Somebody might look bad because they started something and didn't finish, but they should never start it from the first place, so just cut it off. Mm-hmm. Best thing to do. Work of ministry, disciple nations, reconcile earth with heaven. These are just some of my added notes, saying what that was, okay? From Genesis to Malachi, the mystery of Christ was hidden in the ages. Ephesians 1 says that the mystery of the body of Christ was revealed. You must understand the significance and importance of the ecclesia. Ecclesia means more than to be called out. It means a special force called out for a special purpose, a unique coalition. It means a special force. This is the definition basically of the church. A special force called out of darkness, called out of the world for a special purpose, a unique coalition. The predetermined destiny of the church is the restoration of all things in heavenly and in earthly places. We're going back to the original mandate. Why God put us on earth. We're here to complete that. We're here to fulfill that. We don't believe that the earth is just going to be... You know, it says clearly, and God told Noah, he's not going to destroy the earth. Mm-hmm. Told him that. It's not going to happen again. The only thing that's going to happen is the restoration of the earth, mm-hmm. not the destruction of the earth. New heaven, new earth. The earth is being new. It's being new. We're renewing the earth. It will be new. Jesus will finalize that work mm-hmm. on his return. But we are preparing the way for that. In Matthew 28, Jesus transferred apostolic power and authority to disciple nations. How can you disciple nations from the bottom up? The church has not had an apostolic strategy. It has had evangelistic strategies. Save souls, pastoral strategies, you know, maintain the sheep, and teaching strategies. Even the prophetic strategy, like John the Baptist, has now emerged as a forerunner, but behold, the apostolic is rising. Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Apostolic people are not just comfortable just being a little church and having no influence. Mm-hmm. Just being a little church and going, waiting until Jesus returns. We want to disciple nations. We want to see government change. Thank God. I mean, the people that are being put in position right now, as I continue to read every day, mm-hmm. only God knows their hearts. I can't say that, but at least on paper, the majority of them are Christians. Mm-hmm. There's never been so many Christians in office at this time. That's a positive thing.
Yeah.
Maybe they're just Christian on paper. I don't know. We're going to find out. By their fruit, we'll know them. But there's some positive things. We want God's people in every area of life.
Mm-hmm.
Hearing from God. Doing things God's way. That's God's heart. Matthew 28:18-20.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus killed. I said that one? Okay, yep. Let's move on.
Jesus gave.
We're almost at our break point. Jesus gave the Ephesians four gifts unto the church for the purpose of edifying the saints, for the work of the ministry, to disciple nations, and to reconcile all things in heavenly places with those things in earthly places. Basically, bringing heaven down. Ephesians 4, as it is in heaven, so here be it on earth. That's our role. If you're a lawyer and you get saved, now in the law field, as it is in heaven, so here on earth. In the doctrine, you know, as it is in heaven, in every field of society, that individual now is to learn as it is in heaven and then do it here on earth.
You don't change your, you don't stop your profession because you get saved. Because when you take your profession, allow God to enhance whatever it is.
Yeah.
To,
and the old school mentality, which I've been raised up in, and you know, really was, you know, if you're saved now, you need to leave your possession, profession, and become a pastor, a missionary, yeah. or whatnot. But that's not an apostolic mindset.
Yeah, it's not even scripture, but
yes, yeah, just yeah. Allowing the devil, the world we live in, is big part of it is a result of that mentality. You know, the devil was having a field day in Hollywood and all so many different places. Hollywood used to have Christian screening. A movie had to be screened by Christians before it was allowed to be released.
Television too. Censors.
Television, yeah, censors, all that Christian people. We let it all go, and the devil said, okay, I'll use it. You've done a good job. But we're taking it back, right? Right? The hallmark of first century, or I mean Ephesians, okay, and he himself gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. This is the second most popular apostolic scripture. Mm-hmm. Till we come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That is the heartbeat of the apostolic, to see people like Christ. People, my message Sunday was called Like the Father. That's the desire, to see people reflect the Father. And how does that happen? The fivefold nutrients are the key. We need to receive from pastors, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. My heart is to see those fivefold people raised up in this body to be a blessing to the body so that the whole body is getting the full nutrients. Some people are very weak in many different areas because they're not receiving the proper nutrients. They're not getting the proper knowledge and having a full mindset. You go to school, you have to learn certain subjects to get a proper education, to be able to be a good citizen. And that's the same in the body of Christ. We need the right understanding, the right perspective, so we've got to get the fullness. In many churches, you don't have that. You got one person doing all the teaching, all the time, from one gift. And that just doesn't help the people grow.
Interesting.
To the extent that they can, at least. The hallmark of first century apostolic ministry was their militant, or the mentality of militancy. Mentality of militancy. The first century apostles had a mission, global dominion. Global dominion, according to the commandment of God in Genesis 1:28 and Matthew 28:18-19. What is Genesis 1:28? It's the dominion mandate. It's, we shall have dominion on the earth. Mm-hmm. That's our call. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, have dominion. That was God's first assignment given to mankind. And now through Jesus Christ, that is restored.
Amen.
We now can walk in that. Jesus walked in that. Matthew 28:18-19 was the discipling of the nations. So that's the heartbeat of the church today, is to have dominion, disciple nations. They were looking for not only a transformation of souls, but also the society and culture that those souls dwelled in. We see that in the church turned Rome upside down.
Mm-hmm.
The church influenced the entire nation over time. Sad thing is, then the institution influenced the church. But in the initial part of that, the power of these apostles and the followers totally changed the strongest nation in the world. Well, that nation now actually accepted Christianity as their religion, which killed it for a time. But now we're being restored. Even in the restoration of the apostles, if you see over the last few decades, and it's kind of weird, in the beginning of the church, the church really was started by the apostles. Now, during the Roman time, when the church was institutionalized, it lost its organic power. It basically died. We had the Dark Ages as a result of that. And then Martin Luther came, a few people before that, but Martin Luther was the main name. And as he studied the scriptures and he looked into the word, he realized that there's something not right with his practice. And he wrote down the theses and wrote all the different things, and that began the Reformation movement. And in the Reformation movement, different truths have been restored. Every denomination was birthed in a revival that restored a truth. Problem was that many of those denominations, when the new truth was restored from another group of people, they rejected that out of their own pride. And that's why we have such a division. But over the last 100 years or so, especially with Pentecost that took place in the 1900s in Azusa Street. Since that time, the office gifts have been restored. So in the early time, we had the teacher gift, was really the first one restored again. See that in operation. Then you start seeing the pastor gift. And in the 50s, the evangelist, that was the thing back then, the tent evangelism, mm-hmm. Billy Graham and all those stuff was in the 50s and going into the 60s. And the 70s was really teaching as well. But the 80s started the prophetic gift was really the emphasis during the 80s. Dr. Bill Hammond was really a big key person in that. And the 90s was the apostolic. In the 2000s, it's called the Restoration of the Day of the Saints. Now that the fivefold ministry is in place and operating again, not that they never were, but it's been an emphasis of the Holy Spirit. Now that the fivefold ministry is in place, the saints are getting properly equipped. And what does that mean? Now they're beginning to grow and to be active. Mm-hmm. And it's been spoken, Dr. Bill Hammond, from 2010 and beyond, he believes that we're now in the time of the kingdom age. And now we're going to really see the kingdom advance. The kingdoms of this world are going to start crumbling, and the kingdom of God will start rising. What does that mean? What's the next age? The millennial age. Jesus returns. Mm-hmm. When is that process restored? Only God knows. But we're living in really exciting times. The first century, okay, we talked about that. Dominion. Paradise was not intended to be a place of limited geography. God commanded Adam and Eve to fill the earth, not just Eden. There is a mentality in the church that has stopped us from progressing into every sphere that the Lord has commanded us to take dominion over. You know, I have many Christians I've heard over the years since I've lived here won't even go to Atlantic City. That's the devil's ground.
Yeah, they say just like that too. Right?
It's the best place to go if you want to witness people.
The Lord said, fill the earth. Let my glory fill the earth.
Don't worship.
You're supposed to not be afraid of darkness. Yeah. Light, how can light be afraid of darkness? When light is turned on, darkness goes where? Dispels.
Yeah.
So light should never be afraid of darkness. If we're afraid of darkness, it must be because there's still darkness inside of us.
Right.
Fear. The yeah. Darkness. Yeah.
Excuse me. I mean, I've prayed a lot, and I ask God, you know, why am I not being called to go to Haiti or to go to Russia or to go to Africa? You know, why aren't you calling me for those mission trips? And I felt God spoke to me because I'm using you right where you're at in Atlantic yeah. City. Mm-hmm. He said, you are my ambassador in Atlantic City on your job and in the city. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, because I never really, really used to think of that as a mission ground.
Oh,
but
yeah,
it truly is.
People
is.
And dope.
23 really years is. In the casino. Yep.
Oh, yeah. I felt Trump. Like, I mean, right after I got saved, my desire was never to be in the U.S. Like, I was supposed to be in other nations, especially Africa. That was my heart, Africa.
Yeah.
Caribbean, Latin America, but never Europe or U.S., no way. But this is where God sent me.
Yeah. He
wasn't on the map. I remember somewhere down the line I had a vision of being in a church, leading a church, or being leadership of a church, and it was in the East Coast. At the time I just didn't know. I thought it was Carolina maybe or something. But I remember having that dream, but that's the only thought I had of U.S. It was an intermixed church, and it was really cool, that part of it. But I was set. I was going to the nations, but reality is God wants to fill the earth. Mm-hmm. And it's put us in some tough ground. This is some of the toughest mm-hmm. ground there is mm-hmm. in the world. And that must mean we must be tough people.
Mm-hmm.
We must have a tough assignment. Mm-hmm. And God's sending people here. Some of you have been raised up here. Some of us have been actually sent here from other places. So that must mean God doesn't send people someplace that has no hope. That there's no way that things are not going to turn around.
Amen.
So we got some hope.
I was planning on going, had planned on going back home. I'm from the South.
Mm-hmm.
I really had absolutely no intention
yeah.
of staying anywhere close to the North.
Mm-hmm.
And it just would not let it happen. I'm like, I have people ask me, like, yo, why are you here? And I'm like, oh, don't ask me that question, dude. keep, he won't let me leave. And I've had my mother ask me, when are you going to leave Jersey? I'm like, Ma, come on. Yeah, this is where he wants me at for the moment. And, yeah, tough ground.
He doesn't give me any picture beyond here at this point in my life.
Well, thank God I got pictures outside of here. God almighty.
I know I'm going to travel again, but I don't see any permanent
leaving. I think this is going to be a...
I think this is my base of operation, even when I travel nations again 5 to 10 years down the line. But
it's very interesting.
So, yeah, God has a purpose here, and there's a big purpose. There's some amazing prophecies over this area,
and I
believe it's coming soon, a turnaround. You know, I'm seeing Atlantic City, and there's a lot of... so many different ideas floating around, so many different people looking and possible investments and turning into more of a family resort area, college, and all that. There's some opportunities. So I believe it's time that it stops being an apostolic people. What's our job? This has been prophecies I've heard since I've been here. I'm tired of just hearing it. You have to see it. What can I do, God, to see it come forth? What's my part to play?
I'll tell you, I'm a timeshare manager. I sell timeshare. So people come into work every day, every single day. And I said, boy, you really put me in a very challenging position. One is to keep the people that I work with on, how can I put this, with the mindset of helping others first before thinking of yourself and your paycheck first. Think of what their needs are. And when people come in, there's a sales presentation that you do. And it's so funny because there's so many times, like, at first I was just like, oh, God would say to me, I want you to pray for this person. What? Are you kidding me? I have no idea who this person is. They came in from wherever, you know, for a timeshare presentation. And I'm like, in my mind, I'm talking to them, and there's a little battle going on in my mind. And then I kept, all right. And then I'll say, you know what? I'm sorry, but the Lord is asking me to pray for you. I don't know you. I don't know what your needs are. But would you mind if I prayed for you? And then I realized that God will never put us in a position to hurt us or embarrass ourselves. So that always, gosh, opens up the door. And for 45 minutes, I found myself talking to people, you know, and ministering to them, and not even talking about timeshare. I mean, it was just like, okay, that's what I was supposed to do today. And even our developer was so cool. He's Jewish, and he's very esoteric, very spiritual kind of guy, always searching for truth. And for years, like Eric, I worked with Eric. Eric and I were directors together. And for years, we've been preaching to him. And then finally, one day, we got him into one of the offices, and we got him to accept Jesus Christ. And it was just, man, I keep an arsenal on my desk, and I have Bibles, and I have this, and I have that. And the developer says to me, Taylor, you do what you do. Just don't get me sued. And I realized the Lord will never let that happen, you know? But I say, use me as your vessel today. What do you want from me, Lord? And he certainly makes a point of putting those people in front of me. So, I mean, it's amazing, you know?
Yeah, we're available no matter where you're at.
In that profession, whoa.
As long as you get out of your bed, even in your bed.
Wherever.
Somebody use you.
You know, you said, you were saying God never sends you, he won't send you to a place without, that doesn't have hope.
Yeah.
Earlier, last week, he's been hitting me with the, I have no idea what Nineveh looks like, but I've been hearing Nineveh, and he was kind of letting me know that the reason that it was, that Jonah was so impressive when he got there and talked to them is because he came out looking a hot mess. He came straight out of the belly of the fish. There's not another more powerful testimony than somebody who just survived something like, what? smelling like, what? You know, in the whole nine. And, but he turned the entire city because his transformation of obedience was immediate. They saw it, and he walked right into a place that shouldn't have had hope, but he sent them there because they had hope. And I think this area, the areas that God's been sending me to, has been like that, because they can look and say, well, that dude, he went through so-and-so, and, you know, but he's not sending me to places without hope, and I think that's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
That's awesome.
He sent you.
That's just confirmation when you said that.
There's an assignment. There's an assignment. Isn't given for not to be completed, and it was completed, and some work has been done.
Yeah.
Something happened. So, we're going to take a break in just one moment. Let me finish this little last part here. Paradise was not intended. Okay, we got that. Everything within the earth is to be subdued for the purpose of God, that His glory may cover the earth. So, everything we see that is not like God, our job is to subdue it. It's our role through prayer and through whatever action God gives us. Genesis 1:28, then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. The apostolic is not a new way of preaching or a hierarchical structure. It is a mentality of warfare to cover the earth. So let's get our minds off it being the apostles, the chief, this, because people are now calling themselves chief apostles and all kinds of crazy stuff. There's the apostolic church too. Denomination itself, the hierarchy, structure, and all that kind of stuff, but the true apostolic is just a mentality. That's what it's about. The apostle, of course, is Jesus, but the apostolic is a mentality of warfare and dominion and taking back what the devil has stolen. And so here's the fill in the blanks. Do you have some? Yeah, you have some. As you see the notes, those are my notes. You can't read it. Sorry. I tried to white it out. But it was too much whiting out, so I said, I'm just writing my slop. Can't read my writing.
Write it in. Great.
You might not be able to.
I can read it.
I'll go over it.
Like my husband.
So this is the summary of, I just like to get it over with. That's my way of writing. Not good, but that's how I do it. I'm going to get it over with and get back to prayer. Implementing a prophetic mandate was this first lesson. Apostolic ministry moves from proclamation and impartation to implementation. The apostolic is about the return of Christ and those things which must occur before He comes. The church cannot expect to fulfill the mandate of God without following this formula. What is the mandate of the ecclesia? To fulfill a purpose, the restoration of all things. Why were the Ephesians 4:11-13 gifts given? Equip the saints for the work of the ministry, the edification and unity and perfection of the church. What was the mentality of the first century apostles? Militancy. What was their mission? Global dominion. Again, but our fight is not with flesh, because Islam wants to do global dominion too. But they fight with weapons. Physical, flesh, not spiritual. Global dominion is not only the transformation of souls, but also of society and culture. True or false, paradise was not to be a place of limited geography.
True.
What are the two primary scriptures commanding global dominion? Genesis 1:28, Matthew 28:18-19. Because it's 8:05, we're going to take a 5-minute